So where we're going to start today is we're actually going to look at song forms that do have choruses. We're going to look at some of the conventional popular song formats that have choruses, but we're also going to look at variations of those song forms. We're going to do a lot of writing, and then in the second half, what we're going to do is look at song forms without a chorus and talk about what they are and what possibilities are available there and what variations on those song forms also exist and what's possible in that space. We'll do a lot of listening. I have a guitar in case we need it. We may or may not. So that's kind of the format for today. The other thing that I will say is that there are slides for today. I will send all of you a PDF of the slides. So don't feel compelled to take notes on the slides or write down the song references. You'll get those in a follow-up. That's all I have to say. Does anyone have any questions just before we sort of get stuck in? Okay, so one thing I want to say, I want to just like watch a little warm-up video here, okay? So does anyone know who that is? Well, it's got his name up there, damn it. It's Billy Collins. So Billy Collins is a famous American poet who was the poet laureate in the United States for several years. He's just a wonderful poet. I love playing this poem because to me, it sort of shows what we do as writers, even though he's not a songwriter, but even just with words and imagery. This is this amazing poem called The Lanyard, and to me, I draw a lot of inspiration as a songwriter from this song, because what he's doing here is taking something seemingly random and going down a pathway and suddenly coming upon these amazing connections of what this seemingly meaningless object, the lanyard, actually connects to in his life. And for me, it's such a beautiful representation of what we're doing when we're writing songs and what's possible. So let's have a quick listen to this poem.
For a TV, the world is thinking.
I'm going to read a poem, a few more, about what American children tend to do in the summer. It's called The Lanyard, and it's a poem, I guess, for the, you know, what does what most poets tend to do, which is, if you want to write something, write about a topic that's rather large, you choose kind of an image as a point of entry, rather than taking on the topic in a frontal way. So, The Lanyard. The other day, as I was ricocheting slowly off the pale blue walls of this room, bouncing from typewriter to piano, from bookshelf to an envelope lying on the floor, I found myself in the L section of the dictionary where my eyes fell upon the word lanyard. No cookie nibbled by a French novelist could send one more suddenly into the past. A past where I sat at a workbench at a camp by a deep Adirondack lake, learning how to braid thin plastic strips into a lanyard, a gift from my mother. I had never seen anyone use a lanyard, or wear one if that's what you did with them, but that did not keep me from crossing strand over strand again and again until I had made a boxy red and white lanyard for my mother. She gave me life and milk from her breasts, and I gave her a lanyard. She nursed me in many a sick room, lifted teaspoons of medicine to my lips, set cold face cloths on my forehead, and then led me out into the airy light and taught me to walk and swim. And I, in turn, presented her with a lanyard. Here are thousands of meals, she said, and here is clothing and a good education. And here is your lanyard, I replied, which I made with a little help from a counselor. Here is a breathing body and a beating heart, strong legs, bones, and teeth, and two clear eyes to read the world, she whispered. And here, I said, is the lanyard. single admission that when she took the two-tone lanyard from my hands, I was as sure as a boy could be that this useless, worthless thing I wove out of boredom would be enough to make us even.
Okay, great. So actually, before we do this writing exercise that I have for us, I actually want to do a different writing exercise based on this. This is very me, by the way, to have created a roadmap and then immediately divert from it. Okay, so we're going to do a writing exercise that some of you are familiar with. It's a writing exercise called sense writing. So what I'm going to do is give you a single word prompt, and I'm going to set the timer for about 10 minutes. And you are just going to write about whatever comes up for you based on this prompt. And Stephen, do you have anything to write with?
No.
I have things for you to write. Here, you can come up here and grab whatever you need. You're going to write about whatever comes up, whatever you respond to from this prompt. The only limitation or parameter is that you need to stay sense-bound. Okay, so what I'm going to do, in fact, here, you know what, I'll just write it straight up here, is I'm going to write the senses here. So we have sight, sound, smell, taste, and touch. Okay, these are our basic senses. So I'm going to give you a prompt. You're going to dive into a memory, a mash of memories, some flight of imagination, whatever it is. The best advice I can give you here is try to get into a specific scene or moment. Don't try to write about the abstract concept of a rose. Say the prompt was rose. We don't want to be talking about a rose represents this and represents that. Let the prompt trigger some specific situation, scene, or moment from your life or from your imagination. Get inside that scene, look around, and describe what's there using your senses in as much detail as you can. Not at all, and in fact, it should not be lyrics. So there should not be rhyme, there should not be rhythm, there should not be meter. This is really an exercise in responding to a prompt and practicing sense-bound description. Okay? And it's kind of a warm-up exercise, right? So we're kind of taking a prompt from Billy Collins to say, you could open the dictionary on any day, search down the column L, see the word lanyard, and if you start writing about lanyard, it's interesting to see where it leads. It doesn't have to lead anywhere, okay? You can just write, and you're still going to get benefit out of this if you stay sense-bound, okay? So I'm going to set the timer for 10 minutes. Let's do 8 minutes, actually, okay? So 8 minutes, quick. 8 minutes, and then we'll move on to another exercise. Okay, so your prompt is old T-shirt. Old T-shirt. Okay. Does 8 minutes feel fast or slow?
Super fast.
Oh, yeah. Good. Would anyone like to share their writing with us? We obviously won't have time to hear everyone's, but it would be great to hear one or two. Great. Go for it, Nick. Nice and loud.
I pulled it off the washing line and it was flapping. Collar half torn away. It had that smell. The one she always turned her nose up at. Not that I blame her. She was sensitive. A good thing and a bad thing, I guess. On the good side, she knew how to touch. So lightly on my arm that it was like she was there and not there. So lightly but so memorable that I can't put the sensation away. On the bad side, she would react to every noise in the neighborhood, making it into a whole story, especially at night in the dark, padded, special frisson of mystery. I used to like this at first, the sight of her excitement, at the mystery of everything. But sometimes she worked up a kind of fear that made me want to yell at her, for God's sake, it's just a rattling pipe, or a cat knocking over a garbage bin, or a possum thundering across the roof. Anyway, we'd get into sensitivity arguments, where the talk or the taste of the words in her mouth was bitter, and the sight of me drove her mad. All I had to offer really was vague attempts to smooth down all those ruffled feathers, and stuff I wasn't good at, like positivity.
Great, thanks Nick, that was awesome. Well done. I'll read out mine as well, just to give a little sample as well for those who are less familiar with sense writing. I think especially Donna, you know, this exercise is great for people of any age, you know, this sense writing exercise. And I've got some other good references for you if you want other materials you can bring into a classroom. Okay, so when he lifts his arms to fling a child high to the sky with delighted squeals, little pilot astronaut acrobats, I see the holes in his t-shirt. They are Emmental cheese holes, not small dainty holes. They stretch like quasars and crab nebulas. The threadbare t-shirt, still one he wears to work because he loves it. I can smell the sweet sweat from his bike ride home, lingering like a warm cloud around him, like the build-up of a summer storm. He puts the kids in front of the TV, that chattering blue babble of high-pitched voices, and he makes dinner, dumplings, the mix of mirin and soy and miso blending into a sweet vinegar, punctured by astringent onion. This person that I love, that he has more allegiance to this t-shirt than to social conventions of attire and possibly hygiene. That he cares not a drop for hierarchies that reinforce arbitrary systems of power and ego. This dumpling chef slicing shallots like a pro, the crisp wick-wick of Japanese steel thunking the wooden cutting board. I love that I get to tumble in this wash cycle of life with him. Oh, thank you very much. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. No, so the point, I mean, look, I also have about 20 years of practice doing that exercise, but it is, but you don't need 20 years, I always say this, you don't need 20 years to sort of make this writing exercise work for you. If you do it every day for a week, you get into the vibe and you get into the zone. But what I love about this is any day of the week, you can start with any random arbitrary prompt and end up somewhere interesting. You know, just like the lanyard. So one of the reasons why this is a nice exercise to start with, even though we're here to talk about song form, is the reality that song form is the bottle to the wine, but the wine is really the content. You know, so song form to a certain extent doesn't matter at all if the content isn't good. You know, so we still need to focus on the content, understanding that song form is not going to fix all our songwriting problems. You know, we still need great content, but great content can fit into lots of different bottles, you know, and to the extent that, like a bottle of wine, the bottle is sort of a thing that people respond to, you know, so too do they respond to song form, but we still want to know how to get to content. So this is a lovely exercise that on any day of the week, is likely to lead you to some really interesting content. Yeah, and connect sort of something seemingly random to something quite interesting in your own life and memory and psychology. We're going to do another writing exercise, and I know some of you who are in my classes have done this recently, but we're now going to gear towards writing exercises that are going to bring out specific aspects about song form, okay? So I'm going to get you to do another piece of writing. We're going to spend another 10 minutes now that you're a bit warmer, okay, with your writing. For the next 10 minutes, I want you to write about a difficult decision you've had to make, either recently or in the past. I want you to ground the writing in a specific situation, scene, place, event, or moment, just like you did with our writing that we just did, okay? Use your senses to describe it, but also explore what it felt like in your body to be inside that uncertainty. So feel free not just to be descriptive about the sense-based stuff, but also to explore what it feels like, what you're thinking, what are the thoughts inside your head, what does this mean to you, what are the emotions of this decision. Does it make sense what I'm asking you to do? Does anyone have any questions? Okay, so if you did this recently, you can just pick a different one. Okay. Any other questions? Okay.
So this is not song form either?
Not song form either. Yep. The reason, Shelley, that we're not doing it in song form or lyric form is that I do want to take actually 3 minutes to talk about this because I think it's really but it's even a great just point as far as lyric and songwriting process goes. For me as a songwriter, one of the things I have learnt over time and now is just part of my songwriting process is that I never write a lyric line by line. Like a song for me is not written beginning to end, you know, one line like that. It is more like a spiral process, or it's more like a putting a lot of stuff out there. And the songwriting process is actually more about picking and choosing from an abundance of material. And this is one of the great ways to not really ever experience the feeling of writer's block, is actually to start from a place of abundance around an idea and to do writing exercises like this where I end up with, you know, 600 words or something, you know, so now I'm actually just writing by picking things and connecting ideas, but it's never line at a time on a page, as far as lyric writing goes. Yeah. So not in lyric writing form, just in prose form, essentially. That said, you do not have to write in full perfect sentences at all. You know, I will write in very loose and creative grammar and syntax when I'm doing these exercises. Okay? Any other questions before I hit that timer? Okay. So 10 minutes starting now. Go for it. Okay. Oh, I got into a hole there, running as a duck leg. Okay, so we are going to use that writing that you did as the basis for more writing, but we'll kind of do that progressively, right? So the idea that you've got here and that you've been writing about, we're going to use that as a way to talk about song form, but we're going to get there, okay? So before we get there and come back to this writing, I want us to talk about what a chorus is, right? So we talked about what it's not earlier on, which is it's not or not only the bit where the lyrics repeat. So if that's not really what a chorus is, what is it? What is the function of a chorus? And also, what are common attributes of a chorus? So what do I mean by function? I mean, what is its job in a song that is different than any other section?
To get the essence of the song.
The essence of the song, yes. Mm-hmm. Other ideas? Yes. So what would you say is one of like an attribute of a chorus that makes it that part, Luke?
Maybe not the hook or something.
Okay, so it contains a hook. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and what is a hook?
Something that maybe really captures the attention of the listener.
Okay, great. So even at like a lyrical level, so you're saying the actual words themselves grab the attention.
Yeah.
Okay, yep. Any other ideas of what a chorus is? Yes. So great. So that's one of the attributes of a chorus, right? So that's, yep. Yes, so it repeats, absolutely. Anything else? Scott?
Yeah, it gives a sense of resolution to the thing that you're about, the tension that you're putting on the chorus.
Yes.
And kind of pulls it into focus sometimes. Like
yes.
Before you be living, no matter how specific, sometimes it becomes a big one.
Yes. Okay, great. Any other ideas?
It binds a song together.
Mm-hmm.
So it's what you consistently come back to. So it kind of binds the whole of the song into, I guess you'd say, one work.
Yep.
By, through its repetition.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So add extra weight
to each time. Yeah, great. Yep. So that's a nice description of like an attribute of a chorus is that it's something where we can return to it again and again, but we can approach it from different angles such that the meaning, even though the words might be the same, the meaning or the feeling is changing every time we hear it. Yeah, that's a great idea. Good observation. Any other ideas of how it's different than a verse?
Yeah, or coming back musically to what the vocal or whatever, mostly.
Okay, yep, sometimes, yes. Yes, coming back home. And I think that kind of calls to ideas of its job is something to do with resolution, which also speaks to Scott's idea. Was that you, Scott, who said it's like a resolving place? Or, yep, it's sort of a resolving section. Yeah, all of these are great ideas, okay? Let me offer you a few other tips and pointers on specifically lyrically what a chorus is that is different than a verse, a pre-chorus, or any other section that you would have in a song, okay? So for those who we've covered these ideas recently in class, we're going to go a lot deeper and a lot further, okay? So don't worry about it. So the chorus really is the response to the problem. That can mean lots of different things, though. So we can understand that as the chorus housing the peak emotion, the central idea, the core message. It may be expressed as the main need, want, or desire. It may be what most needs to be said, that burning thing that you need to express to someone. It may be the question that most needs to be answered. And that's really important, because a response to the problem doesn't mean an answer to the problem. It doesn't mean a statement or some, you know, words of wisdom, although it can be. But the response might be the question that most needs to be answered. I always think about the John Mayer song, Why Georgia, where the lyrics are, am I living it right? Am I living it right? Am I living it right? Why? Why, Georgia? Why? You know, it's just a series of questions, but the whole song is, am I making the right decisions about my life? I don't know what I'm doing. You know, so it's sort of a story of that moment in young adulthood where you're making a series of decisions, trying to set yourself up, but you really have no idea whether the decisions you're making are the right ones, right? And so, in fact, the response to the problem of that song is the question itself, which is really nice. It may be a realization or an insight. So it may be the lesson that has been learned from dealing with this problem. It may be the decision that has been made or the action that will be taken. There are so many great choruses that are built on the idea of, so I'm going to, I'm going to swing from the chandelier. That's what I'm going to do. And I'm having a shitty time and I'm lonely, so what am I going to do? I'm going to swing from the chandelier. That's basically what that song is. Right, the problem is, actually, it's quite a complex song, actually, if you look into that song by Sia. It's not just a party. It's kind of like, I party because I'm trying not to deal with my suffering. And so what do I do with my suffering? I swing from the chandelier. Yeah, it's a lovely song. Most importantly, the chorus is not just another idea or even a summary idea. It is a response to the problem exposed and developed in the verses, which is great because it actually also tells us something about what verses are, doesn't it? That verses are there to expose a problem, a tension, or a conflict. And if we were sitting in any storytelling class, whether it was screenwriting or fiction writing or anything, and I know that we have amazing writers in this room with us, it would actually be the same idea. It's that, what is a story? A story is conflict. It's where we start in one place, but we want to be in another place. And sometimes that's small, you know, sometimes that can be very, very small. Sometimes it can be big. But conflict is the essence that is developed in the verses, and the chorus is the response to that problem. I say these things as if that's true all the time. It's not. There's, of course, going to be exceptions to this rule, but these are handy thoughts, I think, for, you know, 80 to 90% of the great songs that you hear. If you think about this in relation to those songs, you'll find it's true. And for those that it's not, you'll find some other cool way that they're developing an idea and that there's a relationship between the chorus and the verses that maybe doesn't fit exactly here, but is probably related in some way. It's also musically. Yes, it's absolutely also musically. Although, you know, to talk about the chorus as the response to the problem, for me, I mean, I'm drawing a little bit of a parameter here, Luke, around what I'm talking about, and really focusing on mostly on the lyrical component rather than going too deep into the musical component, because, again, that's a rabbit hole. Yeah, it's a totally separate, you know, it's too deep to try and cover in detail. But I would absolutely say it's a musical issue as well. And for me, form follows function. And by form, I'm talking about musical decisions. And function, I'm talking about the function of the sections, you know. So absolutely, musically in the sense, there are really only three musical functions in music, right? Like if we are writing in music, in Western music that has a key centre, generally, right? Like we're writing in the key of A, for example. There's really only three chords in music. Does anyone know what they are? Yeah, 1, 4, and 5. But it's actually not just 1, 4, and 5. It's what 1, 4, and 5 represent narratively. Scott? Yes. That's exactly right. The story I like to think about my story is this. I like, you've got a shower curtain murderer. I've got a
murderers at the moment.
I've got, this is my story. Here I am in the key of the A. I'm 18. I'm going backpacking around the world. I'm healthy, I've got some money, I've got clean clothes. Here I go. I'm in Italy. I'm in France, I'm in Europe, I'm traveling, I'm experiencing the world, it's great, I'm making friends, I'm having sex, I'm doing drugs, it's awesome! I've run out of money. Mum, can you send me $400 so I can buy a plane ticket home? I'm hungry, I'm tired, I've got fleas, please, bring me home. I'm home, sleeping in my bed. So to me, the journey is home, traveling, tension that desperately wants to resolve and go back home. And the only way to resolve this tension is to go back home. And if I don't go back home, if I go anywhere else, I'm not there yet. I'm in a layover in Singapore Airport. I'm stuck here for 16 hours. But all I really want to do is sleep in my own bed. And it turns out those four functions, home, traveling away, desperately wanting to return home, are the only three functions in music. Every other chord actually generally is one of those three things. We're either expressing a resolution to home, we're expressing a journey away that could actually kind of go anywhere, that's forward motion, right? That is involves a level of tension because we don't know where it's going to go, or we have chords that create that singular desire that can only be properly satisfied by the return home. So, and it doesn't mean that we need to return home. It means that we can go somewhere else entirely, you know, but by not going home, what we're doing is extending that tension. We're delaying that resolution. But why would we delay that resolution? Only in the service of making the return home even more satisfying, you know? So yes, in the sense that music and chords also represent narrative for me, there's absolutely a relationship. And when I'm setting something to music or thinking musically about the relationship of the lyrics I'm writing to the music, I'm always thinking about that. You know, I'm thinking, is this the moment where I'm trying to establish home and resolution and the home base? Or is this the moment where I'm trying to imply the journey away or create tension? And if I'm trying to create forward motion or a sense of tension, how tense am I trying to make it? You know, and that's going to decide whether or not I'm sticking in this sort of like subdominant zone, as Scott said, which is kind of like the four chord, but there are other chords that fulfill that function, or whether I'm really picking chords that are going to, you know, create that desperate need to return back to resolution. So yes, that was a small diversion, but great question. Does that answer your question, Luke?
Yeah.
So it does require a little bit of music theory, but even Shelley, you know, I imagine that a lot of the ukulele songs that you would learn on the ukulele are basically 1, 4, and 5 songs. Yeah. And the reason is because the relationship between 1, 4, and 5 is the most like archetypal narrative musical relationship in Western music. You know, it doesn't get any better than that, actually. Yeah, for me, at least. Any other questions at this point? Yes, Stephen.
Are you always writing your lyrics?
No. Oh, do I have a smart answer question to that? No, sorry. My smartest question is when someone says, do you write the lyrics or the music first? I always say, yes. Which is to say, sometimes lyrics, sometimes music. My happy place is when the two things start together. But for me as a songwriter, I'm so lyrically driven, Stephen, that it's very difficult for me to progress with a musical idea until I actually have a lyrical direction. But that's just me. This question differs from person to person. So I have a friend who's a musician in a great Australian band. I'm going to tell a bit of a toilet, like, humour story here. So he has this very weird YouTube show called Stevic's Shit Show. And in this show, he's in a band that has quite a big following, so he answers fan mail. And in this one episode, he got this fan question that was like, hey, Stevic, do you wipe your bum standing up or sitting down? And in this video, he goes, what? What kind of question is that? Who wipes their bum sitting down? And I watched that and thought, oh my God, who wipes their bum standing up? And Stevic, in exploring this thing, was like, it turns out that 50% of people wipe their bum standing up, 50% of people wipe their bum standing down. Everyone thinks that everyone else does it exactly the same way, but they don't. And, you know, to discover that half the population is doing this thing in this completely other way, they're like aliens. Who are these people? To me, lyrics and melody is kind of the same thing, whereas for me, I'm someone who, I can't fathom the idea of actually writing a song's music without quite quickly having a lyrical idea, but I'm very aware that there's 50% of the songwriter population who are completely different than that. To them, the idea of lyrics first is a bit weird. They're like, how would you know what a song is about until you've got the music? You know, so they seem like aliens to me, but I seem like aliens to them. So there's not a right way to do it. There's you can sit or you can stand. Yeah.
You know, that's all.
Yeah.
He's entirely musical.
Yeah.
And then gets to the lyrics.
Yes. And then by the same token, I was going down a YouTube rabbit hole watching John Mayer do like talk and be interviewed, and he gave this great interview on the radio, and the guy asked him the same question. He's like, John Mayer was like, look, man, you can noodle for hours like this going. You know, anyone can do that, actually. Do you know what I mean? But it's a completely different moment when you start going, I wish I could come back home. I wish I could stay with you. And I wonder, right? It's a completely different thing when you sort of take that plunge into putting words and melody to the music and something happens there. You know, you're suddenly heading down a path with a sense of purpose, and in doing that, like, a song is born, you know what I mean? But if you're sort of endlessly, for me, I'm talking about me, Steve, you know, for me, endlessly noodling on chords doesn't get me very far. But also for me, like, even going, like, it gets me somewhere, but for me, until I'm putting some words to that, that's when like something has happened and I can kind of go, you know, it's sort of the energy takes off for me when there's lyrics and music, but for me there's like a lyrical thing. So it's still personal, you know. I'm not sure there's a right answer to that. I would just say if there is a right answer for me, it's that idea that, you know, you just have to make some decisions, you know, and kind of start to put something down and put chords and lyrics and melody together in order to just get that wagon train a moving, you know, and other decisions will happen faster once you've made initial decisions, you know, but sort of endlessly noodling for me is kind of doesn't get the energy going, I think. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Sort of. Yeah. There's really, it's the answer to this is as varied as every individual, you know, like I just, in terms of answering that question in a way that, assuming Lynn that your question is sort of like, it would be nice to know what the right way to do it is so that I'm doing it correctly, I just don't think that there is, you know, every single. Melody or chords. I don't know statistically. I mean, I have an inkling that it probably comes from chords in the sense that to gather chords together is also to make a statement of the key or scale or mode that you're in. and that's kind of like a bed upon which the melody can rest, you know. So I know that, you know, Elton John, for example, who, when you're talking about the music person, like he's sort of like the quintessential music person, right? Like he doesn't write any of the lyrics, he just deals entirely with the music. Like he, you know, I've seen interviews with him where he talks about it's all about the chords, you know, so it's all about getting a chord progression and then that implies to him the melody. But again, the melody comes pretty quick. It's not writing a whole chord progression, it's just getting something going so that those two things can speak to each other quickly, so that the chords can speak to the melody and the melody can speak to the chords. But yeah, I think that you probably, by starting with chords, create a sonic bed that tells you what your mode or key is, if that makes sense. Yeah. But of course, there are times, like for me and for other songwriters, where you'll have a melody in your head, you know, and there'll be some kind of melody, and then for me, it's about going as quickly as I can, figuring out what key that's in or what key I want it to be in. Is that in the major or the minor? And then kind of getting a chord progression fairly quickly around that melody so that I can give it a bed and give it a structure and progress it forward from there. Yeah. Yep. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Is there a little point when you're going from lyrics to rhythm before you get to melody? You find that rhythm can give you a sense of where you want to go with the melody?
When you say rhythm, do you mean like a beat or a groove?
Yeah,
I mean, this is also one of these things where I do it in a very particular way, Chris. Like, no, but probably to the detriment for me. Like, or it depends what the project is, actually. Like, when I'm writing a song to a brief, that will be quite important quite quickly, you know. So a song to a brief that's for a specific project or, you know, writing to a brief for film and TV or something like that, you know, because tempo, even as, like, the base rate of groove and rhythm, is one of the most definitive factors of the overall sort of energy of a piece, you know. So it's super important if I'm trying to write something that's sort of upbeat, it quite literally has to be upbeat, you know, if that's the energy that I'm trying to convey in that piece. So that factors in. And then it might factor in if, again, more to a brief, I'm sort of going, look, I want it to feel like this genre or sound like this. Then yes, I might seek out rhythm and groove pretty quickly. But when I'm sort of not writing to a brief like that, if I'm just sort of like explorative songwriting, that's less so for me, but I'm not promoting that method of writing. I think the groove is super important. Yeah. Certainly tempo. Yep, certainly tempo. Yep. Yeah, certainly. Yep. Let's move on so that we can cover as much as we can here. Okay. So the other thing that I want to say is when a chorus embodies one or more of these ideas lyrically, it tends to become lyrically independent of the other sections. It expresses a core idea, and that core idea could apply to many different stories or situations. So this is another both function and attribute of a chorus, which is that we don't actually need to hear any of the verse lyrics to understand what the meaning or message of the chorus is. That's when you know that you have a chorus lyric and not actually secretly a verse lyric in disguise that's just wanting to be repeated but actually feels awkward to repeat, because you're sort of telling narrative or describing something that doesn't actually warrant description again, right? It's like telling the punchline to the same joke twice. It doesn't make any sense to do it again. But when you have a chorus that embodies one of these things, it tends to become independent of the verses and therefore encapsulates a core idea, central message, peak emotion. I'm going to keep going, remembering that you don't need to take all these notes because I will send you the slides, okay? Let's take a listen to a couple of examples, and I've just sort of summarized on the left-hand side these ideas, and what I'd like you to do as we're listening is think about which of these ideas over here do you see represented in the chorus of this song? And it could be multiple of these ideas, right? But I want to know whether this feels like a peak emotion or a want or a desire or a question or a decision or action. Here we go. Okay, what do you reckon, Chris? Need, want, or desire? Yeah, absolutely. Anything else?
Another one.
Yep. Anything else? Peak emotion. Yep. 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 Yes. Great. And maybe even this idea of what most needs to be said, right? In all of this stuff, what I most want to say to you is this. But, you know, this is the nature of the song. Certainly the primary thing here is need, want, or desire. Yeah, absolutely. Let's listen to another song example. Oops. Oh, come on. Okay. Here we go. There's another pop song. She's a great songwriter, this one. Okay, what do you reckon? Amelia, do you have any ideas?
I think it's a question and what
it means. Yeah, great. Yeah, awesome, absolutely. Anything else?
Also a realization.
Yep, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, great. So, for me, it's useful to see that there are a list of chorus writing prompts that I regularly use in my songwriting that helps me take whatever idea I'm working with, and when I respond to these prompts, it helps me figure out what exactly is at the heart of this idea. And these are different prompts, and the idea is this: not every one of these prompts is going to yield something, but there's going to be one of these that feels like just the right question for your song idea, where it sort of beelines into the heart of where the emotion is in this song, what the emotional heart is in your song. So I realized, so I decided, so I'm going. That's why I always say, what I really need to tell you is I'm so scared that what I most want to happen is what I need to know right now, you make me feel dot, dot, dot. And even this one I find useful. If I am a blank, then you are a blank. And that's more like a foray into metaphor to say, okay, how can I encapsulate this feeling I'm feeling for or about you or this situation as a metaphor image? You know, in this situation, if I am the concrete, then you are 1,000 feet trampling upon me. It's a bit dark, jeez. But certainly, interestingly, I don't know if looking at this list of questions, can you put your hand up if one of these questions you were like, oh, that's the question I need to ask of my writing prompt about the hard decision? What was the question for you there?
I was so scared of that.
Yeah, me too. Yeah. Anyone? Was there a different prompt here for anyone else?
And what's her? I'm so scared.
That was the person that jumped out. Yeah.
What I really need to tell you is.
Yeah. Great. Yeah. So a different question. Yeah, Shelley. Great. So it's interesting, isn't it? How for everyone's different thing they were writing about. One of these things hit that the core message or the core idea or the central emotion. I want to explore a couple of these in response to the writing that you did, okay? So we're going to go back to this writing exercise. This time what you're going to do is respond to these prompts, okay? So I want you to finish this sentence. So for each of these prompts, I just want you to finish the sentence, so really in about 2 minutes. So I'm going to set the timer for 2 minutes, and there'll be three of these, okay? So go for it. So it might be what I most wanted to happen was, or what I most want to happen is. Okay, the next prompt is the most important insight I gained from that experience is, and now this is also a, and so I realized, right? That might be another way to start this sentence, and so I realized, or I have realized. Okay, so 2 minutes, go for it. Okay, one more prompt. This is what I'm going to do from this point on. You could also start a sentence with, so I'm going to... dot, dot, dot. Go for it. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to put up this other list just for a couple of minutes so that you do have a chance to write them down, because I don't want you to have to wait to get these slides to put these into action, because I imagine that there's probably a bunch of half-finished songs that you have at home that if you took this home tonight and asked these questions, the song's going to go somewhere. Okay? There's always homework to do. Okay, so write these down so that you can use them tonight. Such a good question. Look, there are lots of different approaches. In Nashville, for example, the protocols for writing songs in Nashville, which involves a lot of co-writing, the expectation is that you're going to come into a session with a book of titles, and that's how you write songs, is you start with the title, from that title you write a chorus, or you sort of talk about what that title could mean, what a song could be about with that title, talk about the narrative, talk about the situation, the context, the characters, you know, what are all the exposition qualities, but that in terms of writing the actual song, you'll write the chorus first. so that you have the anchor of the song and that every lyric and everything then just points towards the central idea and the central message. So it's absolutely a great way to write a song, and if you've never done it, you should definitely experiment with it. And again, it's great because it forces you to know what the song is about at the beginning. And then everything else is just directing towards that central position. That said, in my experience, you know, you don't always need to know what you're writing about in order to start writing. And I think writing would be very boring if we always set out on the writing journey knowing exactly what was going to happen. You know, I think it would get stale and your songs would end up predictable. Because if they don't surprise you at all, they're not going to surprise anyone else. So for me, there's virtue in the process of just writing for the sake of writing. And I had the great fortune of hanging out with Janice Ian. I don't know if anyone knows who Janice Ian is. Yeah, many years ago, she came to Berkeley to do in Boston.
Serious brush with banking.
I know. She was great. I think she liked me too. So we were like hanging out. And she was very open about the idea that she writes to find out what she's writing about. You know, so, but that said, I always think and describe the songwriting process, Shelley, as like a cocktail glass. It looks like this to me, but it's more like a funnel, which is like your song can start anywhere. It can start with a chorus. It can start without a chorus. It doesn't matter where it starts, as long as things at some point filter down to this kind of bottleneck. And the bottleneck always happens for me, which is no matter where it starts, no matter how it develops, there's always going to be a point in the process where I make certain decisions. There always has to be a point where I go, what is the title of this song? What is the song structure? And a bunch of other actual structural decisions, like what is my actual rhyme scheme? What is the actual melody? I've changed the melody 4 or 5 times every time I sing this. It's something different. I'm actually now going to sit down and decide what it is so that there is an archetypal version of this song that is the song, that it doesn't change every single bloody time. You know, I'm speaking to myself here. It's like, this is what I constantly do. I'm like, the melody's vaguely this. I'm just riff on it, every, you know, so there has to be this bottleneck moment where I'm making actual decisions. It's this and not this. It's this and not this. And at that bottleneck, that's when the song, you know, becomes a song and not just an idea, you know. So can start here, can start there. If you start with a chorus, you've kind of made some pretty important decisions early on, which is great, but it doesn't have to be that way. As long as at some point, you know, my teacher and mentor at the Berklee College of Music was a guy called Pat Patterson, who comes and does workshops sometimes in Australia. Who knows if that'll ever happen again. But one of the gems from him that I always carry with me is find the title at your earliest possible convenience, which is to say, doesn't have to happen straight away, but whenever you do come across something and you go, ooh, that could be a title to this song, grab it, you know, and also grab it knowing that you're not committed to it, you know, but simply by grabbing it, what you're doing is saying, this song is actually about this and not about this. Even though I might change the title and make it more interesting or compelling or image-based or something, right, at least I'm saying the idea of this song is this. And that, again, it helps sort of like give energy to the song and move it forward and progresses the idea. Okay, so you've got that list. We're going to move on here. We've done this kind of work here, just chorusy, 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 which is great, and versy, 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 which is also nice. But there are other songs in song forms that we need to, sorry, other sections in song forms that we need to talk about. Okay, so what other sections do we have in contemporary song forms? So we already know choruses. We already know verses. What else is there?
Bridge.
Pre-chorus.
Middle eight,
yeah. So middle eight is sort of bridgey, but I guess when we're talking about middle eight, sometimes it's more like instrumental based. But bridge and middle eight, I would sort of call something the same. Yep.
Coders,
great. So something happened at the end. Say again.
Interludes,
excellent. Yep. So we can have sort of musical or instrumental interludes. Sometimes those interludes might be a musical interlude that creates contrast or variation. Sometimes it might just be an interlude that's vamping over, you know, the verse chords or the chorus chords, but yes, it's nice to know that we have interludes that can give us spaciousness in our songs. What else?
Intro
is very important, so on the other end of coders or outros, we've got intros. And identifying intros as its own independent part of a song form is great. And again, we could spend a completely separate 3 hours simply talking about intros and approaches to intros, okay? But, you know, thinking of it compositionally and saying it doesn't just have to be strumming one chord or strumming the four chords of the verse, that there's actually compositional decisions you can make about your intros is really, really important. And I would also say one of the significant differences between sort of mediocre songs and excellent songs is actually how you deal with your intro and the compositional decisions you make with your intros. So intros are great. Anything else? Well, I'm glad that we're all going to learn something today. Great. So here we've got lots of things that we already talked about. A couple of other parts of song form that are useful to have vocabulary around because they help us identify what's going on in songs that we hear. You know, and when we can name it, we can use it. That's central, okay? So we also have the hook. And I think the hook is part usually of the chorus, but not always. Right, and it's useful to go, the hook is its own little part of a song form that we can actually use compositionally elsewhere. Right, I can construct an intro out of the hook. Right, I can lift the hook out of the chorus and put it in the intro. And in fact, I could do it lyrically or I could do it musically. Right, I could actually have an instrument playing part or whole of the melodic hook as a way to foreshadow the hook when it comes. So, hook is interesting.
Sorry, Keppie, I've never really been clear about what it is.
A hook is a memorable, interesting, and distinct lyrical and melodic moment in a song.
Okay.
Usually, that houses the title of the song. There are other ways that people use the word hook. So, sometimes, you know, in that in this Sigrid song that we heard just before this song, so there's a couple of different hooks in her chorus. So she's got the title hook, which is, can I be basic with you? Right, so that's a hook, but also the ooh, ooh, like that little non-lexical vocable. It has a name. It's a non-lexical vocable. Non-lexical vocables can also be hooks. Yep, so we can have sort of lyrical hooks. We can also have sort of vocal melodic hooks. You can also have like rhythmic hooks. So they're catchy, memorable, and distinct musical moments. But when I talk about hooks, I'm really talking about when they have lyrics to them, so that it's not just a musical hook, it's a lyrical and musical hook. Memorable, interesting, distinct. You're welcome. Okay, what else do we have in our contemporary song forms? We have post-choruses. Isn't that interesting? So this is an innovation to song form that's happened, I'd say, in the last 10 years. A post-chorus is described and talked about in contemporary song production. Like if you were in a writer's room today with contemporary songwriters, we talk about post-choruses. So we don't sort of go, why don't we just do a little thing after the chorus? It's like, let's write a post-chorus. So a post-chorus is a section that happens after the chorus, okay? But it contains a short lyrical and melodic hook, usually drawn from one aspect of the chorus and repeated. So it's actually a more simplified version of the chorus where we actually trim the fat and only sing the hook. And sometimes it will introduce some other hook, like a second hook, but it's more a more simple section that's there to drive home the hook. And it's a really fun section to play with because you can either put the post-chorus after the first chorus or you can sort of save it for the second chorus and deliver something new and interesting and fresh that's happening at the second chorus, which is quite fun.
Would you have a post-chorus after a refrain line? Because doesn't the refrain line actually do that?
Yeah, so look, a refrain line is something else. A refrain line is, when I use the word refrain line, I am specifically talking about a line of lyric that repeats in two or more verse sections, and almost always in a song form that has no chorus. So songs that have refrain lines don't have choruses. The refrain line substitutes the function of the chorus. So usually you won't have a post-chorus because there is no chorus. But how fascinating, Chris. I've never thought to write a refrain line song that has a section that I would identify as being a post-chorus. But I love that idea, and I think I'm going to use it. Thank you. I will. Post-refrain. Yeah, absolutely. Exactly. So build-up and drop is a... also, you know, words and vocabulary that are used in contemporary songwriting studios and production and writing rooms. And it's language that's borrowed from electronic dance music. So in electronic dance music that traditionally was instrumental or in its early days, but now has super influenced contemporary pop writing. They would talk about build-ups and drops rather than pre-choruses and choruses, but that it really serves the same function. But there are conventions of build-ups and drops that are distinct from just pre-choruses and choruses. So a build-up is usually when there's some kind of riser, which means an increase in the frequency level. So that literally might be pitch-wise, so a melody is rising. It might also be in synthetic sounds where the pitch mod wheel is actually going up, so everything's going woo. Usually the bass will actually drop out, the drums will drop out, except for some light rhythm. And so what's happening is we're building tension, and then we get the drop. And so what the drop is the reintroduction of bass and drums. And that's when everyone goes wild. But you hear the influence of EDM or electronic dance music build up and drops in pop music, even like the song Firework by Katy Perry. The pre-chorus is identifiably borrowing this rising technique, and then when the chorus comes in, it feels like the drop. You know, the bass and the drum sort of kick back in. Should we take a listen to that so you can hear what I mean? So here comes the riser pre-chorus. Do you hear how there's no bass? Do you hear how there's no drums? Oh, we don't even get the bass yet. They haven't even dropped yet, it's still rising. The tension. Drop. Okay. So super EDM. Okay. And you hear it all the time now, I would say increasingly. Electronic dance music production and ways of approaching songwriting are certainly like influencing contemporary pop songwriting. Yeah, big time. Yeah, look, the whole pre-chorus is a rise. Say that again. Yeah, exactly. It's a repeat chorus. Yep. Yep. Yes, exactly. Great. So we're going to listen to a couple of contemporary songs now that we have this palette of sections available to us. We're going to practice identifying the different kinds of sections. In order to actually preserve time, what I'm going to do is skip over the Sigrid song. Because to sort of foreshadow it for you, and you can listen to it when you get home if you're curious, it really represents what we think of as the contemporary pop song format, which is verse, chorus, bridge, chorus. And I feel like everyone has relatively comfortable with that concept, right? There's a bit of variation in there, but what I want to do is listen to some song forms that aren't that typical or that are variations of that pop song format, okay? So let's listen to this song, Smoke and Mirrors by Sweet Talk Radio. And as we're listening to it, what I want you to do is identify the song form, by which I mean label the section types as you hear them. So it might be intro, verse, pre-chorus, verse, or whatever it is. That's not actually what it is, but whatever you hear, I'm interested to know. Okay, here we go. Okay, so what do we have in terms of song form? Who wants to give it a go?
It confused me.
Good. I'm glad.
I had intro, verse, pre-chorus, but then I didn't hear a chorus. So I couldn't have a pre-chorus, because there was no chorus for me.
Huh?
So I got confused.
I had a two-bar intro.
Yep. Okay.
Then something that I thought might have been a pre-chorus, followed by possibly a short chorus and post-chorus.
Whoa!
I'm glad you were confused too.
Great. Yes. Yes. Great. Good.
Well, I don't know. I feel like there were two different verses that were alternating.
Okay.
Verse A, then verse B, then verse A, and then chorus, and then the chord key thing, or if that maybe
And then there was this middle section which was amazingly different to anything.
Yeah. The bridge, I think. I don't know. Yeah,
I thought it was after a bridge.
Yeah.
My confusion remains.
Great. Let's listen to it one more time. And as we're listening to it, I'll type up what I think is the song form to this song. We're still in a verse. Vocal hook. Verse two. I'll happily call this a pre-chorus. I would call this bridge too. Great. I think that this is a very functional representation of the song form of this song. So you'll see, song form is like not actually a science. And it's interesting that even for me as I listened, I was like, you know what, I would call that a pre-chorus. Because to me, the idea of like, what is a pre-chorus and why do we call something a pre-chorus? We don't need to call it a pre-chorus. We could call it Ethel, George, or Banana. It's sort of like we're only using a word to describe something if it functionally is telling us something important about what's happening in the song and the song form. So to me, the reason why initially I was sort of like, I don't know that I actually call it a pre-chorus is because you can absolutely have a verse that you know, is built in two musical sections, you know, like an A-B verse that has two halves, and we don't necessarily call it a pre-chorus. So I'll show you an example of a song in a moment that has a verse built in this A-B format, and in fact, it's a great example of a song with no chorus. Okay, but so to me, I was like, it's not necessarily a pre-chorus here, it's just that the verse is doing a good job of building enough tension that we don't need a pre-chorus. So that's a good indication of where it's appropriate to put a pre-chorus, is if your verse has not created sufficient tension, which is completely fine. It's totally fine for a verse to end on a big old fat one chord. But that's a good indication of where you do need to insert a pre-chorus, because we need something to create the lift required to deliver the chorus. But it doesn't mean that we should always be sticking pre-choruses into our songs. If the verse has done a sufficient job of establishing tension, we don't need one. For example, let's listen to Sweet Baby James.
Just before you do,
okay.
Can I make a short comment?
Definitely.
In solo songwriting,
yep.
We do someone else's all the time, but not like this.
Yep.
Because we're working mostly from charts, but we don't get the charts until later in the week, what we're supposed to do is to sit with the songs and analyse them.
Mm-hmm. So it's so great to do that, and to when in a song that's confusing, where you're like, I don't know how to label that, I don't know, you know, it is great to do exactly that, to just use letters of the alphabet, which is just to say initially, can I hear where things are changing and where the structure is moving on here to some new musical idea, and then go back and actually question and query, okay, well, what is the function of this? Is this the peak central emotion or idea? Is this bit creating tension, or is it creating resolution? That's really helpful.
And if you look at most sheep, most charts,
mm-hmm.
they don't say first chorus, they say A, B, C.
Yes, yes. Yeah, exactly. Yes. And that's because you're not writing that song, right?
Exactly.
You're just reflecting what's there.
Yeah,
which for me, it's important for me as a songwriter to label these things because it tells me something about how to write songs, you know? So that's why I'm interested in doing it.
Yeah.
Mm.
Rather than, oh, okay, that bit is that the chorus or the verse? Well, no, it could be A to start, and then you go, I'll go back, oh, well, A, that would be the verse.
Great.
And then as I'm working through the song, C,
yep.
C repeats.
Yes.
Repeats.
Yeah, great. Exactly. Great. Let's listen to Sweet Baby James by James Taylor as an example of a song that creates sufficient tension in the verse that there's no need for a pre-chorus. And we'll talk about exactly how he's creating tension here because it's done in really specific ways, okay? And then after we do this, we'll take a break. Okay. So there's a number of ways that this verse section is sufficiently unstable that we don't need more instability. We don't need more tension. What are some of the ways? Any ideas, Chris?
Extra line at the end.
Extra line at the end, definitely. So the best way to see how this works is to take it away. And as the moon rises, he sits by his fire, thinking about women and glasses of beer, and closing his eyes as the doggies retire, he sings out a song which is soft, but it's clear. We could happily hear the chorus there, but he's a better songwriter than that. The other problem with this is that it currently sounds like a dude getting his buzz on, hanging out with his dogs, feeling pretty good. But this is not a song about that. This is a song about someone experiencing desperate loneliness and solitude and looking for companionship. And so to put an unbalancing, destabilizing line there that throws the whole closure we thought we had from this lovely ABAB rhyme scheme, he shoves another one in there and says, no, it's not a comfortable song. It's not a song about someone feeling good. It's a song about someone being very lonely. And also that fifth line throws us off kilter and takes us by surprise, right? And so then the chorus comes in and we're like, oh, here's the resolution that we need, because this fifth weird surprising line sort of threw me off here, right? So then he delivers the resolution. The other unstable thing, of course, is in terms of lyric structure, is the rhyme scheme of the first section. You know, this is not an ABAB rhyme scheme. This is an ABBA rhyme scheme. And again, you can feel the impact of this instability by looking at what happens when you mess with it. So let's turn it into the much more traditional, much more balanced, much more resolved ABAB rhyme scheme. There is a young cowboy. He lives on the range. His horse and his cattle are his only companions. Waiting for summer, his pastures to change. He works in the saddle and sleeps in the canyons. Good night, everyone. Yeah, totally. You know, and so it's lovely to see how a master songwriter makes these decisions, you know, and he's someone who would have made the decision. You know, it's not just blindly stumbling into this kind of songwriting, you know, is no, this is, again, it's not about a cowboy feeling happy and hanging out with his horses. You know, it's not. It's about someone in solitude and waiting for things to change and waiting for things to be better and waiting to find companionship. Yeah, this ABB rhyme scheme is actually drawn from, or most famous actually, from this Tennyson poem, In Memoriam AAH, which is actually a eulogy for a friend of his. And of course, the last two lines are the most famous. I hold it true, whate'er befall, I feel it when I sorrow most, 'tis better to have loved and lost than never to have loved at all. And it turns out this is the last stanza to like a 12-stanza poem, all of the stanzas being in this ABBA rhyme scheme. And again, it's about what does ABBA do that ABAB doesn't? It creates tension, it creates yearning, it creates longing. It does not deliver comfortable, stable resolution. And so when you have a song that has all these amazing structural elements of tension, no pre-chorus required, because the necessary level of tension has already been established. We're just waiting for something resolving to happen here.
So is that fifth line a bridge?
No, it's not a bridge. It's just a fifth line to the chorus.
Is it a bridge between the story and the chorus?
Well, you're using bridge there in a colloquial sense. You know, we don't hear it as a separate independent section of music. And we also need to talk about what a bridge is. So a bridge is not sort of one line, or I suppose it could be, but a bridge is really a contrasting section of music that we haven't heard before. You know, or it introduces new musical ideas that we haven't heard before. And its job is to provide contrast, variation, and tension at lyrical and musical levels. So in the sense that this is not, we're just sort of, it's just an extra two bars of verse, basically. Yeah. Let's take a break and we'll come back in 5 minutes. Let's try and make it no longer than 5 minutes so we can persist. All right. All right. Shall we keep going, guys? Because I want to make sure that I get to where we promised we'd get to and talk about song forms with no chorus. So let's listen to this Amy Winehouse song, Love is a Losing Game, and it's the same exercise. So as we're listening, I want you to name the song form, so describe the sections. And again, if you get confused, you might just start with the letters of the alphabet, as Nick was talking about, you know, as long as you are identifying when there's one section and when there's another section happening and what's going on there. Okay, so let's have a listen.
Thank you.
But she doesn't sing the phone book. She sings really good songs. This is a particularly good song. Yeah. So what is the song form here? Does anyone want to take a stab at this one? Yeah, almost. No chorus. Yes, excellent, Shelley.
You call this a refrain song?
This is absolutely a refrain song. Very good. So, Donna, I think you're absolutely right. I think that we can just call this A, B, A, B, A, B, or even more simply, we can identify, like what you were hearing, Donna, was you're saying, look, I hear that things are changing there, right? I hear that the music is going somewhere else there. I hear this is one thing and this is another thing. So it's totally fine to call this, let me write some song forms up here, A, B, A, B, A, B, right? So when I say A here, it's not to imply that the lyrics are identical, it's simply to imply that the structure is the same, or more or less the same, right? Identifiably a repeating section type, right? So A, B, A, B, A, B is correct. We could also simply say, look, each of these A, Bs is just representing two halves of one section. You know, you can build one section out of two halves. Let me sing you a song that I wrote, if I might be so bold, which is just like this, okay? So it's you know, you're gonna hear two halves, but to me, they're just part of the same section. They're two halves to the same section. It's the end of, I'll do it a bit higher. It's the end of the night, the crowds have dispersed, it's just a smell of stale beer and half-smoked cigarettes, and there you are in the corner of the bar, saying just one more, I'm not finished yet. But all this reveling you do has a way of leveling you as you stumble and fall. Ooh, you stayed too late past the last call. So you can hear that there's movement from one thing to another thing. In my mind, it's one section with two parts, one section with two halves. You know, I wouldn't necessarily call, you know, that second half the pre-chorus. You know, it's a song with no chorus. I would simply call it the A section, understanding that it's written in two halves. And that's a nice way to take a song form that actually is what we can more traditionally call an AAA song form and make it more musically complex if we want to. We can construct those A sections with two or even more parts. This, definitely. Yes.
A lot of song.
Okay.
Verse 2. I was really interested in this because to me this kind of says in different ways the same thing over and over again.
Yes.
And it works really, really well. Yet when I'm writing songs, I get really worried about saying the same thing over again in a different set of words.
Yeah, I mean, I think that that's totally valid, and a really important principle of great lyric writing is that the song should move from one place to another and not merely be the same idea dressed up in different words. But sometimes that movement doesn't need to be great in order to be, like, it doesn't need to be big in order to be effective, you know. So for me, there's absolutely an intensification of the idea and a transformation of the ideas through the sections here. I don't see this as... actually, even though she's going, love is a losing this, love is a losing this, love is a losing that, that's the refrain line, but to me there is a recoloring of that refrain line in each section. You know, in this section, this is kind of like, love was this huge thing that bowled me over and, you know, and I sort of regret it. And here she's saying, it's more than I could stand. And then also to me, this idea of, you're a gambling man as well, to me, is a new idea to say, you know, I was bowled over, but you were playing me. You know, to me, that's a new idea. And here, to me, this idea of fate resigned is quite different, you know. It's saying, like, and I lost. It was great, you played me, I lost. So to me, there is a movement of ideas through this song. Yeah. Like, it's not narrative, it's not,
no.
You know, yeah, but it's something else. There is. What a great question. So it is not common if all you're looking at is like the top 50. It is definitely common if you are listening to an artist's full album. You know, so John Mayer is a great example of someone like that, who's all his hits would have choruses. But on his records, you know, there's lots of different song forms and tons with no choruses. Yeah. Absolutely. So this song form, AAA, has a really long tradition in folk music, has a really long tradition in ballads and balladeering. Yeah, we can look at a couple of examples. But even here, there's this John Mayer song. Actually, I don't think I have the lyrics here. Do I have the lyrics here? No. But this is a John Mayer song, Fiery Rain and Meteors, and it's the same song form. It's AAA, so it's a song form with no chorus. But the AAA song form, actually, I'm going to come back to that. I'm going to come back to this idea, but continue answering that question in a number of different ways. So what we have here is an AAA song form. Again, we can make the AAA song form more interesting by having multiple components in that A section, none of which are necessarily pre-choruses or bridges. They're just different movements within the same section. So a really nice example of that is a song by Anais Mitchell. Let me see if I can find this song, Willie's Lady. Anais Mitchell. So I'll play the song and I'll look for the lyrics while we're listening. We won't listen to the whole thing because it's fully 6 minutes long. So let's stop there for 1 second to say what we have is this, right? We could call that A, and then we could, oops, I don't want to comment, and then we can call that B that then repeats. So we sort of have A, B, B. And so each of these sections here is constructed of A, B, B. And then that just repeats over and over again. And in fact, this has a name, this kind of song, the AAA song, is also called a strophic song, in which each of those A sections is what's called a strophe. Random piece of information, when are you ever going to talk? But when it is, you know, strophic. Yeah, exactly, along with non-lexical vocables, okay. Okay, great. So AAA songs, okay? So let's listen to another song form, and we're going to play the same game, which is name that song form, okay? what we're going to listen to? Yes, let's listen to Angeles by Elliot Smith. I miss listening to Elliott Smith. I love it. Can only listen to one or two songs though. It's too sad. All right, what is the song form? Does anyone who hasn't had a chance to speak very much? Amelia, do you want to take a stab at this one? Okay, yeah, that's okay. Anyone else? No.
I lost it.
I got so enthralled in the song.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. We do care because we want to use it. Yes, Shelley.
It sounded like there was A, but then it was like a little pre-chorus or extended bit, second part of A.
Okay, yep, let's call it B. Okay, great. Any other ideas? Yeah, great. That's a really important thing to understand about this song is to hear that there is a repeating part. We do hear a refrain. But the refrain, very much like the Amy Winehouse song, where there is a refrain, there is a repeating line, even though the specific words changes, in every single section we hear love is a, love is a, love is a, right? So that repeating idea becomes the refrain. It's a repeating part, a repeating line. In this Donna, absolutely, we hear, so glad to meet you, Angelus. Now you've sold yourself to the devil, Angelus, or whatever. But we're constantly hearing some repeating line there. The important thing is to go, does that make it a chorus? Did we actually hear a chorus in this song? No, there's no chorus in this song. Yeah, but there is a refrain line, and that's a really good key in to understanding this song form. Let me bring up the lyrics. I think it can be helpful to see them. Angelus by Elliott Smith lyrics. Yeah, so look, one thing I'll also say is the way that these lyrics are written in when you just Google them does not necessarily represent the song form, you know. In a certain way it does, right? So what this person has done as they're typing them out, they can hear this line as the refrain line, right? They can hear, so glad to meet you, Angelus, a sign up with evil Angelus, because I'm all over it, Angelus, and we can hear that it's musically coming at the same point in each section, except for the B section. This song is a song with a B section. And it's the same melody, it's the same cadence, right? It's the same inflection, it's happening in the same point in the structure, which makes it a refrain line. This is a song with this song form. A, with a refrain line. The fact that the chords change doesn't, for me, necessarily make it a different section. I hear this as one whole section. A. So these are musically identical sections, structurally identical sections. And then we have a B section that also ends on the refrain line. So we hear musical contrast here, we hear new melody, we hear some new chords. It does return to the refrain line. And then finally we come back to an A. And this is an extended A. So it's an A section with a slight variation, which is actually a really typical and traditional variation of a final A, which is extending it by 4 to 8 bars before we hit the final refrain line. Let's hear another example of an AABA song. Okay, so this is an example of an AABA song. And Shelley, to come back to your question of, you don't hear it very much, do you? This is the only song form you would have heard if we were listening to pop music in the 1920s, 30s, or 40s. This was the pop song format in the golden, what do they call it, American songbook era. It is the jazz standard form. But you know, understanding that when we say jazz standards, what we're talking about are the songs that were absolutely pop smash hits in the 20s, 30s, and 40s. You know, they were AABA songs. And our song form palette has moved on from there. But this song form, to me, is one of the most beautiful, resilient song forms that has so much to offer as a songwriter. And I'll tell you a bit about, you know, this song form, and perhaps I'll play you the rest of that Last Call song that is an AABA song that I wrote, the first AABA song I ever wrote.
Beatles, this has song form too.
Oh, heaps. Yes, we'll look at some Beatles songs. Yep. So let's listen to, there's a beautiful John Mayer song actually called I'm Gonna Find Another You. So now we know it's an AABA song, so we can listen to it through that lens.
It's really over. You made your stand. You got me crying. As wise as you plan. But when my loneliness is through, I'm gonna find another you.
So here we have extending lines. Great song, right? Yeah, really, really fun. Good. Yeah. Great song. Great. So let's go flick down here for a second. So you were mentioning some Beatles songs, which is a really good observation. Let me show you some others, okay? So historically, again, you know, this idea of AABA songs being the pop song format from the American songbook era is actually not the whole story. So historically, actually, AABA songs, if we were playing in a jazz band, and we were kind of soloing over like a jazz standard, the language that people would use is, let's play once through the chorus. And what people mean in that context is once through the whole song form, AABA. They're using the word chorus in that context differently to the way that we've been using it and that we normally use it. The reason that that language still is a holdover from where these songs came from is because the pop songs from the 1920s and 30s and 40s were actually songs lifted from musicals. So musicals were actually, and sort of operas like Porgy and Bess and those were actually where pop songs of the day came from. It was the musicals that made them wildly famous. And the reason is actually because this, in the 20s, it's actually before the gramophone became a domestic household appliance. So how did people hear music? They heard it in musicals. And then they went to dance halls and they requested the numbers that they were hearing in the musicals. And those became the dance hall hits. And then people bought the sheet music, and that's what pop music meant, you know. And so these AABA songs, like Summertime, were lifted out of musicals in which that particular AABA song was part of a longer musical number and called the chorus because it was the catchiest part of the whole song. But what... Yes.
Like, I get a kick out of you starts with, my story is much too sad to be told, but practically everything leaves me totally cold. The only exception I know is the cave, when I'm out on a quiet spree, fighting vain in that old movie, and I suddenly turn and see your fabulous face. I get no kick.
Yeah, and so it's interesting when you sing that, you're like, oh, and now it sounds like we're the chorus, you know, which is why people listening to AABA songs get confused as to whether there's a chorus, because often they think they're hearing a chorus because the verse contains the refrain, which is the repeating bit. And so people think that they're hearing the chorus when they're not. So it's just an interesting historical fact, but I think that it's lovely to kind of look at the history of song form and see where it came from and where it's coming and where it's going. But also for me, the AABA song form, like I said, is such a beautiful, resilient song form that we've now heard songs in multiple genres that still prize and favour the AABA song form. So historically for musicals and films like I Got Rhythm, Blue Moon, Over the Rainbow, Autumn Leaves, right, all of those are AABA songs. It was still popular in the 60s and 70s, so yes, the Beatles were big fans of the AABA song form. So Blackbird is an AABA song form. It's a slight variation of it, but we'll listen to a couple of variations. Yesterday is just a classic AABA song, actually. Still Crazy After All These Years by Paul Simon is a very famous AABA song, and we're actually going to do a little writing exercise based on that song in a moment. Make You Feel My Love by Bob Dylan, made recently famous again by Adele, is also an AABA song. Again, it's a slight variation of that song form, but its structure and its bones is AABA. And still popular. So that John Mayer song, you know, there's a song, beautiful kind of folk song by Gregory Alan Isakoff, Second Chances. The song The Time I've Wasted by Laurie McKenna, which is sort of an Americana song. Lots of genres, lots of styles still use AABA. So I'm sort of collecting a Spotify playlist of AABA songs, which I'll also send you after tonight. I'll send you the slides and I'll send you Spotify playlists with different song forms so you can sort of hear them in action. You're welcome. Okay, we're going to do this quick writing exercise, all right? So this is just a description of AABAs. We've already talked about it, so I'm going to keep going. Okay, that's another example. We don't need to listen. Okay, so Still Crazy After All These Years This is an excerpt from an interview with Paul Simon. Okay, so Paul Simon said, "In Still Crazy After All These Years, that title phrase came to me first, and it didn't come with melody either. It just came as a line, and then I had to create a story." So we are going to do a writing exercise in which we take the title, Still Crazy After All These Years, and you are all going to write a song with that refrain line. So the first thing that you're going to do is this. We're going to spend 5 minutes and no more working through these exercises. Do we even have time to do this version of it? Yes, we do. Okay, so 5 minutes. I just want you to free write in prose, not lyrics. Just free write for you what a song with that title could be about. Still Crazy After All These Years. Who is the character? It doesn't have to be you, right? You can embody a persona. You can imagine you are a character for whom that is true. Still Crazy After All These Years. Who is the character? Is there another person? To whom are they speaking? Where are they? What's happened? Why are they saying Still Crazy After All These Years? Okay, so 5 minutes to flesh out a song idea, a character, a scene, a situation. What could a song with this title be about? Does it make sense what I'm asking you to do? Does anyone have any questions? Yes, Amelia. Writing ideas, yeah. So kind of like a song summary. Yeah? Like, this is what a song with this title could be about. This is the person, this is the relationship, this is what they've done, or this is what they're going to do. A song with this title. Yeah? Okay. 5 minutes, starting now. Okay. Whatever you've got is fine. We're going to move on to the next part of this, which is this. Based on your idea that you've generated, I want you to reverse engineer at least 3 rhyming couplets that end on the line, still crazy after all these years. So I'm going to give you some examples, okay? I still expect their applause and their cheers, still crazy after all these years. Still waiting for the clowns to appear, still crazy after all these years. I see my own face at the bottom of a glass, so clear, still crazy after all these years. So I want you to generate little rhyming couplets that end on our title line or our refrain line, but I want them to be relevant to your song idea. The first thing you might care to do is actually spend a couple of minutes brainstorming as many words as you can think of that rhyme with the word years. And from that list of rhyming words, generate rhyming couplets. Does it make sense what I'm asking you to do? Okay. So I'm going to actually give you 8 minutes, and at least 3, but as many as you can come up with in 8 minutes. Okay? One more minute. Try and get two more out. Or one more. One more in 1 minute. Okay. Great. So whether or not you came up with something that you enjoy or like, doesn't matter at all. What we've just done is a songwriting process that absolutely represents the way into writing an AABA songs. So this is the sort of, if we pretend that this is a real life songwriting moment for you in your life as a songwriter, this would be the moment when you found the title. Right, so remember we were talking before about sometimes you start with a title, as Paul Simon did with this song. Sometimes you don't have the title. Sometimes you're exploring an idea, you've written something, you don't know what it is, you've stepped away, you've done some sense writing, and at some point, my voice came into your head and it said, find the title at your earliest possible convenience. And you see a word or a phrase and you go, hang on a second, that could be a title to this song. That's the moment when you do exactly what we've just done. Where you write that title down, you brainstorm a list of words that rhymes with not just one word in the title, but actually a good strategy is, if you have multiple words in the title, brainstorm words that list with all of the sounds in your title and start reverse engineering sections. Reverse engineering is a really, really great songwriting strategy. What it does, as we were talking about before, Shelley, in your question about do you write the chorus first, when you reverse engineer from a chorus or a refrain line, you are starting with the target of the song. And what it guarantees is that everything is driving and pointing towards the central idea of the song. And when songs do that, everything comes together. The song really sounds like a song. Let me sing for you, if you'll so indulge me, the rest of that song, so that you can, this was the first AABA song that I wrote after doing this exercise with Still Crazy after all these years. And the magic happened for me because I was meandering down song lane and then I did some sense writing on this scene with a friend of mine and I wrote the words, you know, the barman turned the lights on and off, it was last call. And I thought, ah, last call, ding, 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 there's my title. Because last call is the last call at the end of the night at the bar. Last call is also the last call I can make to you because there's nothing more I can do to help you. Last call is also last call at the proverbial train station of life in which if you don't get on that last train, it might actually leave and you'll never get back on it. So here is this song. I haven't played in a long time, so excuse me if I mess it up. I'll try my best. Let's do it here. It's the end of the night. The crowds have dispersed. It's just the smell of beer and half-smoked cigarettes. And there you are in the corner of the bar singing just one more. I'm not finished yet. But all this reveling you do has a way of leveling you. As you stumble and fall, ooh, ooh, you stay too late, past the last call. You're laughing too loud and talking at a shout, using the music as your alibi. Charming quirks, yeah, they had their perks, but now the price has risen too high. I've done what I can, I've played my hand. Oh, I've given it my all. When I hang up that phone, that'll be my last call. Oh, that's not the right chord. Okay, let's try that again. Here we go. Yeah, you're brittle, you're broken, feeling a little unsure. But this shadow is too dark to ignore. You're sitting alone. Empty bottle lying there too. You're starting to see it's not you drinking the whiskey, it's the whiskey that's drinking you. And maybe all it takes is just enough mistakes till you're up against the wall. And grace is a train about to depart. So when you hear your name, baby, don't stall, or you'll miss your last call. So to me, AABA song forms are a really, really powerful, beautiful song form that force us quite quickly to settle on what is the central core idea of our song and then make sure that all our lyrics are pointing towards that title of the song. We're out of time. I wish we weren't. There is more to be said.
And
I know it could easily have been ridiculous. Thank you so much. I hope that you learned something there. I will send you the slides, and just as a little, looky here, the things that we didn't cover are this, okay? Variations to the AABA song form. So there's little explanations here with examples, so you can explore those at your leisure, okay? So common variations to the AABA song form with some examples. Oh. Okay. So, yeah, it's a good song. Okay, so thank you guys so much. I'll hang around for another 5 or 10 minutes if anyone has any questions. Other than that, you'll hear from me by email with the slides and other resources. And I thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.